Yes.
I received funds because they're going to build a driveway in on my property, okay? Had nothing to do technically with the median, except that I was not going to have to go down 800 feet to make a turn. For their building this driveway on property, they gave me funds to allow for change in my property. I have to move fencing over, et cetera. Same type of funds I received when they took some of my property to widen the street. So that was for the changes to my property. Okay. One, I received those funds because of the acquisition of the land that they were taking. Everyone received funds for land that they were taking, okay? So that's what the funds were. This is so worded to look like they paid me off and I said, okay. But I have less property now as a result. As a matter of fact, the total of $12,000 isn't that bad. They get away with more. They claim they're going to, what do you call when they take your eminent domain, you're taking property. So that was for compensation of property I lost, that I no longer have as a result of the widening, okay, and the driveway. That's what those funds reflect, not just a 12 grand that I got for this Christmas.
I'm going to let Deborah respond to that, but I will say that Mr. Holmes agreed the reconciliation to appease Mr. Holmes and the whole issue with the medium was to put in a new driveway. He was okay with that. That happened on September the 23rd, 2013. So he was okay with that reconciliation to put in a new driveway. I will let Deborah respond a little bit more to that.
Was that toward me as well?
Could I also make a follow-up to that?
Can I respond to that as well?
But she's still responding.
No. Okay, right. Your time is running.
Well, okay, very, very quickly. The majority of all of the responses to and the concerns that residents had along this corridor, we tried to work with the property owners. The resolution that you described was discussed with Mr. Holmes and worked out with Mr. Holmes. And this is the resolution that we came up with. So it wasn't the city imposing a direction, it was a collective decision.
Ms. King was not able to come because of a serious illness. Her sister's very ill, asked me if I could fill in for her. She has asked me to fill in for her on this entire matter. Okay, so I'm not her representative by law. She's asked me, I'm doing this at her request. The same for the church property that between Ms. King and I. The gentleman, the people that own the church right up here that bought it from University Park, they are now getting ready to sell this church up here at the corner, okay? They own the property there. They're going to build between Ms. King's and my home. Again, property owners. Why put a median that first 800 feet? No other reader down the street. They go in and out both directions. You're going to have people at that church making U-turns up and down Slater Road. We just ask the same $14 million, save a lot of thousands, and just don't start the median at Caps Hill Mine Road. Okay, start it at the next corner. That's all I ask. And as I open, I'm not speaking to the city, we have a representative who represents us as, listen to the business community, faith community.
No. I'm saying, where would you
we want our
to work with them?
To say, I know all that.
They're working with you.
Citizens don't want a median between the first 800 feet. I know it sounds good, and you're talking about bike lanes and all that. There is no pedestrian traffic there. No pedestrian traffic. No foot traffic. No one lives across the street. The quarry is on there. They're not going to build homes across the street. Nothing's happening. So that segment, and with the church property there, Mr. Mario Guzman told me yesterday to be it, but they're getting ready to clear that out and build a church there. Why have churches making U-turns right there in that little segment? So we're just asking, citizens are asking the city, don't put a U-turn, make us have to make U-turns. I thank everyone, first of all, I didn't receive all that money on September 23rd. But I thanked everyone because I was showing sportsmanship, if you will. Thank you. At that point, they had only accommodated me, and I said, thank you. I told them, hey, 20% of it still remains. We got the rest of the street. But being the gentleman that I am, and okay, hey, I said, thank you very much. Hey, really? Yes, Mr. Charlie, yes, I'll take this. But we're saying thank you, and I appreciate it. Okay.
One of the things that you may have missed early on is we're talking about safety. We're talking about everybody that travels along Beatties Ford Road. We're talking about families with children, with babies. And we're trying to mitigate the fact that if there's a median there, the chances of an accident between those people traveling along that will be lessened. So we're trying to make sure that everybody, the 16,000 vehicles that travel along Beatties Ford Road, are safe and the people are safe. That is all we're trying to do. And we're trying to make sure everybody that travels per se. So I've worked to try to make sure that this particular individual and this king have their issues mitigated, and we're trying to do that as best we can.
I'll try to respond, and I may take some liberties.
Yes.
From the perspective of Mr. Austin and what he is doing,
mm-hmm.
When I first assumed the responsibility of assistant city manager, which Charlotte Department of Transportation is part of my portfolio, he called me, we met, and that was, I mean, it was pretty intimidating, some of those meetings that we had with Mr. Austin in terms of, Deborah, I got to understand this. I'm accountable to my constituents. I need to understand why, when, and what we can do to resolve Mr. Holmes' issues. He has brought those issues to our staff team. We have made lots of concessions along this thoroughfare. Are we looking at the issues from the Beatties Ford Road in its entirety? Right now, this is the scope of our project. If you have concerns, obviously you can bring it to the city and we will try to respond.
Yeah, so good question. Broadly, and not to go too technical, but broadly, there's a lot of cars that are traveling Beatties Ford Road today. There will be more in the future. And when you have that amount of cars, one of the most helpful things you can do to start addressing things like congestion, keeping people moving to and from where they want to go, along with safety, and that this is no textbook answer, this is proven practice. One of the most helpful things that you can do is to start separating out that traffic so folks can move to and from where they need to go, people can make turns in an organized way. Not having that in place allows for people to start making turns in a very disorganized way, which has the potential for some safety conflicts, but also, and I don't want this to get lost, is that a median has a tremendous amount of pedestrian safety benefit. And so I'm not here to debate how many pedestrians are out today, but I do know each time we have an incident where a pedestrian gets struck across the city, we take it extremely seriously and we try to look for ways to get ahead of the curve and not respond. And so this is an opportunity to get ahead of the curve and not be in a position where we're trying to respond to something that's happening negatively.
And go down South Boulevard where there is not a median and experience that kind of traffic.
And our contention is the same. The car, Greers Grove Road, heading toward Capsule Mine Road. You go by Angie's Diner, you go by Norm Gunn's Tire Center, you go by Reader Memorial Church, and you go by Dr. BB's Medical Center. No median. Nobody's having accidents there. The cars that go by Angie will also go by Kenny Funeral Home. Why are they gonna, when they get up to Capsule Mine Road, now all of a sudden start colliding with each other? It's not happening. True broad sense, median safe.